The Machine Stops by E. M. Forster. One. The airship. Imagine, if you can, a small room, hexagonal in shape like the cell of a bee. It is lighted neither by window nor by lamp, yet it is filled with a soft radiance. There are no apertures for ventilation, yet the air is fresh. There are no musical instruments, and yet, at the moment that my meditation opens, this room is throbbing with melodious sounds. An armchair is in the center. By its side, a reading desk. That is all the furniture. And in the armchair, there sits a swaddled lump of flesh. A woman, about 5 feet high, with a face as white as a fungus. It is to her that the little room belongs. An electric bell rang. A woman touched a switch, and the music was silent.
I suppose I must see who it is, she thought,
and set her chair in motion. The chair, like the music, was worked by machinery, and it rolled her to the other side of the room where the bell still rang importunately.
Who is it?
She called. Her voice was irritable, for she had been interrupted often since the music began. She knew several thousand people. In certain directions, human intercourse had advanced enormously. But when she listened into the receiver, her white face wrinkled into smiles, and she said,
Very well, let us talk. I will isolate myself. I do not expect anything important will happen for the next 5 minutes, for I can give you fully 5 minutes, Kuno. Then I must deliver my lecture on music during the Australian period.
She touched the isolation knob so that no one else could speak to her. Then she touched the lighting apparatus, and the little room was plunged into darkness.
Be quick, she called, her irritation returning. Be quick, Kuno. Here I am in the dark, wasting my time.
It was fully 15 seconds before the round plate that she held in her hands began to glow. A faint blue light shot across it, darkening to purple, and presently she could see the image of her son, who lived on the other side of the earth, and he could see her.
Kuno, how slow you are.
He smiled gravely.
I really believe you enjoy dawdling.
I have called you before, Mother, but you are always busy or isolated. I have something particular to say.
What is it, dearest boy? Be quick. Why could you not send it by pneumatic post?
Because I prefer saying such a thing. I want you to come and see me. Vashti watched his face in the blue plate.
But I can see you, she exclaimed. What more do you want?
I want to see you not through the machine, said Kuno. I want to speak to you not through the wearisome machine.
Oh, hush! Said his mother, vaguely shocked. You mustn't say anything against the machine.
Why not?
One mustn't.
You talk as if a god had made the machine, cried the other. I believe that you pray to it when you are unhappy. Men made it. Do not forget that. Great men, but men. The machine is much, but it is not everything. I see something like you in this plate, but I do not see you. I hear something like you through this telephone, but I do not hear you. That is why I want you to come. Pay me a visit, so that we can meet face to face and talk about the hopes that are in my mind. She replied that she could scarcely spare the time for a visit. The airship barely takes 2 days to fly between me and you.
I dislike airships.
Why?
I dislike seeing the horrible brown earth and the sea and the stars when it is dark. I get no ideas in an airship.
I do not get them anywhere else.
What kind of ideas can the air give you?
He paused for an instant. Do you not know 4 big stars that form an oblong, and 3 stars close together in the middle of the oblong, and hanging from these stars 3 other stars?
No, I do not. I dislike the stars. But did they give you an idea? How interesting. Tell me.
I had an idea that they were like a man.
I do not understand. The four big stars are the man's shoulders and his knees. The three stars in the middle are like the belts that men wore once, and the three stars hanging are like a sword.
A sword?
Men carried swords about with them to kill animals and other men.
It does not strike me as a very good idea, but it is certainly original. When did it come to you first?
In the airship. He broke off, and she fancied that he looked sad. She could not be sure, for the machine did not transmit nuances of expression. It only gave a general idea of people, an idea that was good enough for all practical purposes, Vashti thought. The imponderable bloom, declared by a discredited philosophy to be the actual essence of intercourse, was rightly ignored by the machine, just as the imponderable bloom of the grape was ignored by the manufacturers of artificial fruit. Something good enough had long since been accepted by our race. The truth is, he continued, that I want to see these stars again. They are curious stars. I want to see them not from the airship, but from the surface of the earth as our ancestors did thousands of years ago. I want to visit the surface of the earth. She was shocked again. Mother, you must come, if only to explain to me, what is the harm of visiting the surface of the earth?
No harm,
she replied, controlling herself.
But no advantage. The surface of the earth is only dust and mud. No advantage. The surface of the earth is only dust and mud. No life remains on it. And you would need a respirator, or the cold of the outer air would kill you. One dies immediately in the outer air.
I know. Of course, I shall take all precautions.
And besides, it...
Well? She considered, and chose her words with care. Her son had a queer temper, and she wished to dissuade him from the expedition.
It is contrary to the spirit of the age, she asserted. Do you mean by that, contrary to the machine? In a sense, but...
His image in the blue plate faded.
Kuno!
He had isolated himself. For a moment, Vashti felt lonely. Then she generated the light, and the sight of her room flooded with radiance and studded with electric buttons revived her. There were buttons and switches everywhere, buttons to call for food, for music, for clothing. There was the hot bath button, by pressure of which a basin of imitation marble rose out of the floor, filled to the brim with a warm, deodorized liquid. There was the cold bath button. There was the button that produced literature. And there were, of course, the buttons by which she communicated with her friends. The room, though it contained nothing, was in touch with all that she cared for in the world. Vashanti's next move was to turn off the isolation switch, and all the accumulations of the last 3 minutes burst upon her. The room was filled with a noise of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.